What if you try to do the right thing and it still backfires? Engineers are often so excited to get into the problem solving that they forget to listen. In the next scene, Amos is so eager to talk that he forgets to listen and read the room.
So, tell me about your favorite engineering project.
Okay, well, I changed our architecture to go from one where we had an Apache reverse proxy and a Java application.
Okay.
I built an infrastructure behind a load balancer, a router, a central API connected to several microservices.
Okay.
And then we had to work with having service tokens so that our caches were not getting overloaded.
Okay, so let me stop you there. Can you tell me maybe what the problem was you were trying to solve? Let's set some context for the before and after, the choices and the trade-offs. Let's walk through this instead of sprint. Yeah?
Let me just take a step back, okay?
Now, the candidate was trying to describe a very interesting problem, but he made a number of mistakes in how he tried to explain that problem. So let's start and take a look. To state the obvious, the candidate was way too aggressive and did not listen and did not read the room. As the intervention from the interviewer showed, the candidate also did not explain the problem that he was trying to solve and why it was important to solve that problem. Third, it felt like the interviewer asked a question that was fairly high level and the candidate got from 10,000 feet way over here to the technical weeds in a few seconds. This was an opportunity to demonstrate how an engineer can apply technical skills to identify a problem, devise solutions, and then execute. Instead, the candidate's response came across as a word salad. There is a gradual nature to solving problems, coming up with proposals and identifying the best ones. This involves a bit of back and forth, suggesting and listening. This interview felt like a one-way recitation rather than a collaboration. This is the biggest risk in getting too tactical. You miss out on growth, growing the solution space, and growing as an individual. Additionally, the candidate's answer felt like he confused complexity for impact. Now, I love Italian food, and I promise I'm going somewhere with this. The beauty of Italian food is that sometimes a small number of ingredients makes for a great fragrance and amazing flavor. It is not about quantity, it is about chemistry. Similarly, engineering is not about the number of tools, but how they play together. Context is how they all fit together, like the sauce holding the layers of lasagna. So explain, educate, listen. Those are the soft skills that are critical when you go through design interviews, product prioritizations, and technical refactoring meetings. Technical interviews evaluate these soft skills as much as they evaluate your actual problem-solving skills. Finally, there was too much use of the word I in the interview. Engineers often focus on their narrow and focused remit since they exist in silos way too often. To build on my earlier analogy, they are like members of an orchestra with one instrument to play and do not understand how everyone else plays together to make beautiful music. This engineer was focused on just his instrument and his notes. Unfortunately, in an interview, that makes an engineer seem self-absorbed, disconnected, or worse, as if they're trying to claim too much credit. Remember, a technical interview is about two things. What did you do? And second, how did you help an overall mission? Let's do the interview again, shall we? Now, unlike Amos from the last scene, Stephanie is a much better listener. She draws her interviewer into her ideas and turns the interview into a collaboration session. Let's take a look.
So, tell me about your favorite engineering project.
Okay. We had an architecture that was not scaling well. It had too many single points of failure. It was creating a lot of downtime at critical moments and forced us to incur hardware expenses. But I was part of a team.
Interesting. Can you tell me more about the failure modes?
Yeah. So, we had a monolithic database. It was often overloaded, causing downtime and data inconsistency issues. And our apps often struggled with latency and availability.
You must have had some upset customers.
Yeah. So we had three different teams, actually. The platform infrastructure, cloud migration, and API teams. They all collaborate on a distributed architecture. I'm on the API team.
Okay. So what does this new infrastructure look like?
Okay, besides the load balancer, we set up a cache client. It's a Java-based library. And then we configured the infrastructure such that the service call first hits the cache. And then if there's a miss, we hit the service and we backfill the cache.
Okay. Tell me more about reads and writes and how you prioritized availability versus consistency.
At this point, this seems more like a problem-solving session rather than an interview. Such a difference, right? Now, here's a few lessons. Like I said before, content without context is like lasagna without sauce. Things get cheesy and not in a good way. In life and at work, progress is the outcome of several contributions, ideas, and changes and random occurrences. It is hard enough to fit that nuance in an interview, so starting with too much detail in a rush simply exacerbates the problem. Do not compound the weakness of the interview forum. Include your collaborators in your solutioning process. Then even if you slip up, they are likely to support you before you fall. People are unlikely to follow you unless you try and bring them with you. Finally, make the technical solution relevant to a problem. How did your solution fit into a need? Was it critical to the business, or was it a crazy idea that you were chasing in search of a moonshot? Explain. Educate. Include.